this is a real picture taken recently. You may not know that, of course, NASA never left the moon. We've been studying the moon continuously for the last 50 years. And for the last 8 years, we've had the LRO satellite, the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, that has mapped the entire surface of the moon to an accuracy of a couple of centimeters. And so, you know, there's a time when we actually knew the surface of the moon better than the entire surface of the Earth because of LRO. And LRO had such a successful mission over the last 8 years, always pointing down, always looking at the lunar surface. We actually have allowed it to look up a little bit now that it's in the late stages. And we've been taking pictures of the Earth as it rises over the lunar horizon as the satellite goes around. It's a nice place to start because we're very proud of our planet for being the water planet, for being the only place where we know of that there's liquid water on the surface of the planet. And our view of that is actually changing quite a bit. I mean, we still are the only place that we know of that has liquid water on the surface. But even in our own solar system, there are other places that have far more liquid water than we do. And we're going to talk about going after that liquid water, where that liquid water came from. Now, in this illustration, if you could gather up all of the water on the Earth and put it into a sphere, like a bubble, that would be the shape of it that you see in the upper left of Earth. That's the amount per volume. There's only a little scrum of liquid water on our planet. We're a planet of rock and metal, hard stuff. And there's really just a little tiny film, and you think of it as the water planet. When you go into the outer solar system, and actually we're finding out the exoplanets too, planets from other stars, there are entire planets that are made up largely of water. And many times that's in a solid form, ice. But in the case of Europa and Titan, Europa's a moon of Jupiter, and Titan's a moon of Saturn. We'll take a look at both of those. Volume-wise, if you have the amount of liquid water, not frozen water, liquid H2O, it's much, much larger than Earth. And in fact, in our own solar system, Earth is now in fourth place for the amount of liquid water. But those are two. It actually isn't showing you the one that's number one. Anybody know what number one is right now? It is a moon. It's the moon of Jupiter. Ganymede. Yeah, that's right. In studying the outer solar system, you know, we have just ended an incredible year. You know, it was this September that we ended the, I mean, depending on how you count it, it's been out at Saturn for 13 years, the Cassini spacecraft. It took about 5 years to get out there from launch. And, you know, the thing that just kind of, that was a really sort of wonderful, sad, proud day for me when we actually dove it into the clouds of Saturn deliberately. You know, we had had an observatory observing Saturn out there for 13 years. Saturn has about a 28-year orbit, and that's enough time for us to have watched the seasons change on Saturn. And the seasons actually change really dramatically because the rings cast shadows on different parts of the planet as the orientation of the sun changes in the sky. So we were there all the way through an equinox where the rings were lined up with the sun, and there was basically no shadow. And then as you went, we actually went from winter into summer in the north. And you can see that the whole weather patterns changed based not just on the planet itself, but on the shadows of the rings. This is a picture where you can see the rings edge on. And you can see that just how thin these things are. And you can see the orientation of the sun and how the shadows are being cast, in this case in the northern hemisphere. The rings are about a 250,000 miles across. So they would basically stretch from the Earth to the moon. The moon is 30 times the diameter of the Earth away. So you could fit 30 Earths across the rings. On average, they're about 50 feet thick. And you know, whenever you tell people that the rings of Saturn are as thin as a sheet of paper, there's actually no sheet of paper that's that thin. Much, much thinner than a sheet of paper. If you had a 250,000 mile across sheet of paper, it'd be more than 50 feet thick. As the Cassini mission went on the last couple of years, we started doing riskier things. You know, we thought we'd have a mission for a couple of years. It actually ended up lasting 13. And so over the last years, we've been flying it into riskier orbits up above the plane of the planet itself. And of course, one of the most amazing things we found was this beautiful storm called, creatively, the Hexagon. You never let astronomers name anything. the large part of the hexagon you see there is about two Earth diameters across. And it is amazing. It really does rotate like a hexagon, almost like a solid body. It's due to a very fast jet stream, about, you know, between 300 and 400 miles an hour. And the clouds of Saturn are so cold, there's very little friction. And so you set up, for those of you that know a little meteorology, you set up a standing wave in the atmosphere. And it actually makes this wonderful, clear, delineated storm. We watched that change over the course of a cycle of seasons, and that was just incredible. In the very center of, so the black dot, the very center of this storm, Cassini flew right over it and took this amazing picture of the sunlight lighting up one half of the clouds. You know, this is a super hurricane, you know, several hundred miles across. And again, it's a real picture, and we were really there. And now the Cassini spacecraft has become part of the planet. The moons turned out to be much more interesting than we were expecting. And this is a real picture of one of the minor moons, and you're seeing it against the planet. So that's Saturn in the background, the cloud tops of Saturn. And you're seeing the ring shadows being cast. So again, the beauty of the Saturn system just astounded us. And you know, we learned a lot about the interactions of the moons and the rings. You can see here this little moon that's picking its way through the rings. You know, the rings are made of particles of dust and ice. And you know, even though they're very, very thinly distributed, they're very reflective. So you get this wonderful sort of, you know, photograph record, you know, sort of around Saturn. Just the gravity alone is disturbing the ring particles as it goes past. And it's kicking them up into a wake behind it. And those are spikes that are a couple kilometers high. Spikes of ring particles. Yeah, I can imagine just sailing across the rings of Saturn and seeing that. So the interaction of the rings turned out to be really important. Speaking of total solar eclipses, here's something you're never going to see from Earth because you have to be farther away from the sun than Saturn. Cassini actually flew to the other side of Saturn, the night side of Saturn, and saw this total eclipse. This is Saturn eclipsing the sun in the sky. And that's why you can see all this beautiful detail in the rings, is because the sunlight is scattered through the rings. Yeah. There's a very tenuous outer ring, which was actually called the E ring. And there's, if you look all the way over on the left-hand side, there's a little dot inside that E ring. And that's a moon called Enceladus. And Enceladus had been a bit of a mystery to us, because this E ring shouldn't be there. The E-ring is so far out that those particles should escape into space pretty rapidly. And in fact, one of the big mysteries about the whole Saturn system is why do the rings exist at all? Because Saturn is continuously losing ring particles. There are ring particles flying off into space, and there are ring particles raining down on the planet. And we don't know whether the rings are something that were very old. You know, they're billions of years old, and they used to be huge. And now they just depleted down to the rings that we see now. Or are the rings relatively young? The general thinking right now, due to the Cassini observations of the mass of the rings, is that the rings may be about the same age as the dinosaur impact. It may be something on the order between 50 and 100 million years old. They're probably caused by two moons that collided. In fact, collisions will turn out to be a big theme tonight. So Enceladus is orbiting right smack in the middle of this ring that shouldn't be there. And we wondered if the two were related. And so, you know, these are images of Enceladus taken from Cassini. And we were talking about the amount of water in the solar system. This surface is covered with ice, with water ice. And you can see that this, you know, for those of you that are astronomers and you study things like the moon, this is what we call a very young surface. You know, there aren't any craters. And in fact, there appear to be cracks and fissures in the ice. And so we wondered, you know, we weren't expecting this when Cassini first went out there. You know, is it possible that Enceladus might be geologically active? Could there be activity below the ice? Could there still be liquid water? And this was actually solved very quickly, because as Cassini pulled back from Enceladus, it took a picture of Enceladus with the light behind it, with the sunlight. And we realized Enceladus is leaking. Enceladus is a relatively small moon. It's only about 500 miles in diameter. But those are, we call them geysers, although they're not really geysers, but they're cracks in the ice. And because of the lack of air pressure in outer space, the water's rushing out. And so, you know, this is gushing liquid water, obviously crystallizing when it, you know, hits the vacuum of space. And Enceladus appears to be creating its own ring. So as water flies out from Enceladus and crystallizes, it creates this E-ring. Now, we have been flying the Cassini spacecraft for the last 5 years through those jets of water. And you know, this is one of the things that I would have just loved to see. Cassini got on the order, I'm trying to think, our closest approach to the moon We were something like 30 kilometers above the surface. So in the case of this picture, you would have seen us flying through the bright parts of those water vents, and we were continuously sampling that water. This is one of my favorite pictures. This is an actual image taken looking down at one of those vents, one of those cracks. It's at about 30 kilometers above the ice of Enceladus. And you know, unfortunately, Cassini is an old spacecraft. It was built practically 30 years ago. But we did bring things like a mass spectrometer to try to analyze some of the stuff that's in the water. And in fact, we were able to confirm a number of things. For one thing, there are organic molecules in that water. The mass spectrograph, for those of you that know a little chemistry, the really infuriating thing, it's the best we could do, is that the mass spectrograph can only detect very small molecules. So for example, we detected methane, right? Methane is a small organic molecule. If there actually had been anything living in that water, like say a brine shrimp, it could have just smacked against the mass spec and never gone in. The mass spec could only look at very small molecules. So, you know, we talked about the fact that one of the lead scientists at Cassini said if there's any life there, you know, it could be covered with roadkill. But we just would never know. You know, very surprised brine shrimp get blasted out of a vent and boom, you know, now you're on the Cassini spacecraft. But what we were able to sense, or perhaps even more interestingly, is we were able to actually find these very tiny little bits of silicate rocks, little minerals. And we could prove by the size of these little minerals that they've recently been dissolved in hot water. And what that means is that somewhere below the ice, there's a chemically active surface. There's rock being dissolved by vents of hot water. And that hot water is then shooting up into this subsurface ocean. And you know, from this, we actually estimate there's a huge amount of liquid water. And we believe it's actually entirely global. There's a layer of liquid water under the ice, and it's interacting with the rock and the minerals underneath. On Earth, this is a picture from Earth, we have similar things on the bottom of our ocean, hydrothermal vents. We call them black and white smokers, because the water becomes so enriched with minerals that it almost looks like smoke coming out of the thermal vents. And we can prove that something similar to this exists on Enceladus, in the similar conditions. And it's worth noting, and again, this is a picture from Earth, that you know, everywhere on our ocean that you have a deep hydrothermal vent, you have a completely unique ecosystem. You know, we have oceanographers that work at NASA that specialize in this environment. And they've told me that every single one of the ocean is different, that there are no two sea vents that have exactly the same type of bacteria, the same type of life. They're all different. And you know, we think this is a very likely place that life could be even originated here on Earth. So you know, we now know that there are places in our solar system that have that same potential. And you know, one of the big things now is to get back out there with a better mass spectrograph and actually really analyze that water. Titan is really worth looking at. It's if you notice, it's sort of orange colored. And this is one of my favorite pictures of Titan. There's another moon photobombing it in front. There's sort of a little icy crater moon. I think that's Dione, I'm not exactly sure. But you can see Titan in the background. And Titan should look kind of fuzzy to you on the edges, because Titan actually has a very thick atmosphere. And the orange color that you see there is from long-chain organic molecules in the atmosphere. It's basically smog. It's the same thing. So if you've been, I worked at JPL for 12 years. I know a smoggy day in LA when I see one. And you know, there's sort of an orangey cast to the sky. It's the same chemistry. Titan has a mostly nitrogen atmosphere, the same as the Earth. But it actually has a tremendous amount of organics in the clouds. And Titan, is worth mentioning, is about 80% the size of Mars. This is something that would definitely be called its own planet, except it's orbiting a bigger thing. So it's a big thing. Now, the clouds are entirely opaque in visible light. There's so much smog and so much haze, you can't see down. And one of the big goals of the Cassini mission was to discover what was under these clouds. Because according to our atmospheric models, the air pressure on the surface of Titan is a little more than in this room. It's one of the only places in the solar system where you could actually not wear a pressure suit. It's very cold. You're very far away from the sun. But you know, if you could actually wear a really, really warm parka, you wouldn't need a pressure suit to walk around on Titan. So we actually took infrared cameras. Infrared cameras are very good at seeing through haze and smoke. They're used by most fire departments because heat cameras can actually cut through the smoke and you can see right through it. So what happens when you look down at Titan with an infrared camera is you begin to see some really interesting structure. And I want to just call your attention to how beautiful this is. Don't worry about sort of the blockiness and the lines through the image. Those were just different scans of the camera. But you'll notice there's kind of a glowing area up towards the left-hand corner. And that's actually sunlight glinting off a liquid lake. So on Titan right now, it's raining. And there are liquid lakes that we watch seasonally fill up and drain, and there are huge river systems. This is one of our infrared and radar images. We also took images of these lakes by bouncing radio waves down to the surface radar. And this is called Ligia Mara. It's one of the biggest lakes on Titan. You can see there's a bar at the bottom that says 150 kilometers. So this lake is about the size of Lake Ontario. It's about a similar volume to that. And yes, the surface temperature on Titan is about 300 degrees below zero. So the liquid is not water. It's liquid methane and liquid ethane. It's liquid organics. So on Titan, it's raining organics. And we actually believe that there are heat sources, again, gravitational sources underneath, that are creating layers of liquid water below all of this methane. We actually sent a little lander called the Huygens probe. It was a contribution from the Europeans. The Europeans are really good at landing on moons and small bodies. And this is a real picture. It's a little bit dark, but you can find these as well if you just Google them. This was actually the scene parachuting through the atmosphere of Titan. And we actually landed right by one of the liquid methane lakes. And this is one of the few places where we have a really interesting possible life detection. Now, if we ever find life, I can tell you for a fact, I mean, at NASA, we want to find life desperately. The head of planetary science, Dr. Jim Green, is getting kind of old. And he wants to hang on to be the scientific director when we discover life on other planets. And you know, something like this, we're talking mainly small life, microbial life, that sort of thing. But obviously, we don't have any real proof of life anywhere else. Otherwise, you would have heard it. You would never, ever hide that. But it's a really interesting thing to think about on Titan. There actually is one place on our planet where you get bacteria living in liquid methane. And that's at the very, very bottom of the ocean, in the very deep Marianas Trench. There are areas that are cold enough and under high enough pressure that you get liquid methane. And there are ecosystems of bacteria that actually metabolize the liquid methane, bacteria that live off it. They're called methanogenic bacteria. And when we study these on the Earth, they use a chemical, sort of, it's one we're familiar with, the chemical acetylene. That's a gas that you find in blowtorches and stuff. Acetylene is actually used by these bacteria to breathe, to help metabolize the methane. And I thought one of the really interesting things on Titan is that we were sampling all of the different gases in the atmosphere. And it's mostly nitrogen, there's a little bit of carbon dioxide, a little bit of this, a little of that, a little bit of acetylene. And then right as we went over one of the lakes, the acetylene disappeared, as if it were being absorbed. And to me, that remains one of the more intriguing things about Titan. That the gas that we know, the chemical that we know that methane-based bacteria use here on Earth, was out of balance in the atmosphere of Titan. Yes, but before I go on to another planet, one of the big new missions being considered right now, it's not approved yet, but it's being considered, is a program called Dragonfly, where we're going to send an octocopter to Titan. And so if you think about like a large drone, Titan has a very thick atmosphere, and its gravity is much, much weaker than Earth's. So you could actually fly really easily all around and survey these lakes, and maybe do some really interesting chemical analysis. So that's one I'm kind of hoping gets selected. Okay, moving on into the solar system. Again, these are all amazingly beautiful real images from the Juno spacecraft, which arrived at Jupiter about 2 years ago. And amazingly, this was a battle of NASA. The Juno mission is doing very specific science about Jupiter itself, how Jupiter works, what its internal structure is like, and possibly how Jupiter evolved over time. And the original plan was not to put a camera on it. They were going to send the spacecraft all the way out to Jupiter. And it was going to do wonderful spectroscopy and give us all these great wavy lines that scientists like so much. And the public relations people basically begged the mission. You know, could you just put the damn camera on it and go all the way out to Jupiter? And so they actually put the spare descent camera from the Mars rover. They just stuck it on the side. It was a last-minute thing. And, the pictures that we're getting back, of course, are mind-blowing. So there's Jupiter. It was our largest planet. You could fit 1,000 Earths inside Jupiter. And the beauty of this thing, we've never seen Jupiter from this perspective. When the Voyager spacecraft went by, it flew sort of by the equator, and the Galileo spacecraft as well. So with Juno, we're actually seeing the whole planet. And I love some of these pictures. Those are Earth-sized storms. We were calling those the String of Pearls, the beautiful white storms. We're doing a lot of analysis on the chemistry of what causes the colors of Jupiter. The truth is the exact reaction that makes the different reds and whites we're not even really sure of. So there's just beautiful new images just flying over one of those big storms. Yeah, I said real images. Now, because this camera was actually stuck on at the last minute, there was no funding for image processing. And so this is something that you can actually do. All of this image processing is done by the public. The images from Juno are immediately made public in their raw form. And then we ask for members of the public to give them back to NASA. So you can be the main camera PI for Juno. If you go to the Juno website, you can help us do this. Looking at these giant swirling storms and these huge jet streams. I mean, the whole thing about Jupiter is that the weather is entirely different because, our weather, the sun heats up the atmosphere and then the Earth spins and you get these wonderful convection cells that drives our weather. But in the case of Jupiter, you're so far away from the sun, you don't get any warming from the sun at all, basically. So all of the weather is generated internal to the planet. Inside Jupiter, Jupiter is basically still forming. Gravity is still compressing it, and that's still heating up the interior. So it's actually losing heat to space. And in the very core of Jupiter is hotter than the surface of the sun. It gets up to about 10,000 degrees. And so you have all of this heat generated in the center of the planet. And then this whole giant planet, as I said, you could fit 1,000 Earths inside, it spins once every 9 hours. So our day is 24 hours. You have this big planet that spins around once every 9 hours. So you get these convection cells that come up from the interior, then get smeared out by the rotation. And you get these beautiful bands and all this turbulence in the upper layers. And we are trying to understand the weather right now. The first science coming in from Juno is telling us the interior is different than we assumed. I mean, that's not surprising. We didn't know much about Jupiter to start with. But we wondered whether Jupiter had a solid core, as if it were like a planet that accumulated a huge atmosphere, or whether it formed more like a star. Maybe it doesn't have any core at all. It's all just hydrogen. And the first answer we're getting back from our probes is that it's neither of those, that it seems to have kind of extended fuzzy core that isn't very well defined. So we're still trying to figure out how this whole planet works. So Jupiter, a lot of people say, is Jupiter like a failed star? Is it a star that didn't quite ever ignite? And the chemical composition is pretty much exactly like the sun. So that's kind of cool. That's very much like the sun. But Jupiter would have to be about 100 times as massive as it is before it would become even a very low mass dim star. So stars are definitely caused by different organic molecules at different radiation exposure. Jupiter, I've actually just got to talk about this. Jupiter is baked with radiation. So we think a lot of the colors are actually different radiation levels at different altitudes in the atmosphere. So they create these beautiful colors. You would probably, if he put you out to Jupiter, assuming you're in a spacecraft where there's atmosphere and you're fine, the radiation alone would kill you in a couple hours. Jupiter is really hard to do business around. We'll talk a bit about this. This is the spacecraft that you've seen the images from. This is Juno. And as I mentioned, Juno arrived July 4th to July 4th ago. That was a wonderful time. It got inserted into Jupiter's orbit. It has huge solar panels. This is the farthest our probe to ever use solar panels. These are the largest and most efficient solar panels ever made. And as I was mentioning, the problem with Juno is that we actually expect the spacecraft to only last about 2 years. Cassini lasted for 13 years out by Saturn. And the reason is that Jupiter has this extremely strong magnetic field. This entire planet rotates once every 9 hours, and it takes this huge magnetic field around with it. And so when you are anywhere near Jupiter, you're basically living in particles over here. And we think that would degrade our detectors and basically fry everything in about 2 years. And it's really hard to explore Jupiter because of that. Now, why would Jupiter have such a huge magnetic field? So on the Earth, what generates the Earth's magnetic field? Well, why do we have a magnetic field? That's right, got a metallic core, right? The core is molten, there's all this moving charge. Jupiter is almost all hydrogen. Really not metals at all. What could possibly cause a magnetic field just with hydrogen? The same question, I guess, to some degree with a lot of planets. So this was actually created in a lab at Harvard University for the first time this year. For a long time, we theorized that if you took hydrogen gas and compressed it enough, high enough temperature, high enough pressure, you could actually force metallic bonds to form between the hydrogen atoms. So there actually is something called liquid metallic hydrogen. And Jupiter appears to be mostly that. So it's not correct to call Jupiter a gas giant. Inside, it's very hot, very dense liquid. Liquid metallic hydrogen. And then you rotate that all around once every 9 hours, and you get a particle accelerator. And so the orbit that we have Jupiter on is, basically what happens is every, I'm trying to remember, we didn't get into quite the orbit we wanted, but it's close, but I think it's about every 27 days, we dive in very close to the cloud tops of Jupiter, and then we get the hell out of there. And at least that'll give us two years. So it's a very elliptical orbit. Dive in, get away. Dive in, get away. Europa. And Europa, we've known for a while, has this wonderful surface. Again, it's very young, cracks, ice, probably water underneath. And through especially the Galileo probe was able to do some measurements of the magnetic field of Europa. And you know, we now know that Europa, this one moon, this is about the size of Europa compared to Earth. And once again, they've taken the volume of water on each of these worlds. And then they're showing you that Europa actually, despite the fact that it's smaller, has more liquid water than the Earth does. And Europa, of course, is a huge target for NASA. I mean, one of the things that we actually have called out in the next budget is to have a Europa orbiter to go around and really look at this moon and see if it's a possible environment for life. There were some wonderful close-up pictures of Europa taken by the Galileo mission. And not only are these real pictures, these are actually real color. Europa's cracks tend to be kind of rusty red colored. And we basically modeled that by having salts and organic molecules exposed to very high levels of radiation. So it's almost as if something is kind of filling in the cracks from below. And inside that ice, there's a very interesting chemistry that can react to the radiation around Jupiter. It's worth mentioning that if you are below the ice, you are protected from Jupiter's radiation. So this would actually be a very nice environment for life underneath the ice. And in some areas, you actually see places where there might be hot springs kind of creating these domes, and some of these change over time as well. So we're very interested to see what that ocean is like. Right now, JPL is building underwater rovers that basically are buoyant enough to stick to the bottom of the ice and then roam around in the water. And so they're testing that right now. So the nice thing about Enceladus, the moon of Saturn that we saw, is that there are cracks, and there's water rushing out of those cracks. And for the first time last year, we think we saw that on Europa. This is a picture from Hubble, the Hubble Space Telescope. So all the way back here at Earth. This was not taken anywhere near Europa. But we actually see at the bottom there, on the left hand, you know, sort of at about 7 o'clock, we actually see these sort of white jets that then appear and disappear. So we think that there may be areas near the South Pole of Europa where there are cracks as well. So we don't know how thick the ice is. The ice could be tens of kilometers thick, but in some areas it actually may be relatively thin, and possibly even have cracks that go all the way down to the ocean. So drilling through the ice is a big deal. That was something we really didn't know if we could do or not. We're going to send an orbiter out there to map the entire surface of the ice and look for the most likely place to send a probe. The actual winner of the most amount of liquid water right now, and this is an artist conception, is the moon Ganymede. And Ganymede is the largest moon of Jupiter. It also is nearly the size of Mars. It's more than 80% the size of Mars. And the Hubble Space Telescope actually observes northern lights on Ganymede, northern and southern lights, auroras. Jupiter has so much radiation and magnetic activity that it actually induces auroras on its moons. And of course that means that Ganymede also has a magnetic field. That's pretty cool. But in the last couple of years, we've actually been looking, and here's a Hubble image of Ganymede with the auroras superimposed, different wavelengths with these two images. We've been looking at the way these auroras slosh up and down as the moon orbits around Jupiter. And we model it now as there being a layer of salt water, of conducting fluid under the surface, about 60 miles deep. So if you have something about the size of Mars with 60-mile deep oceans, this is the winner for the most amount of liquid water. All right, I'm going to back up a little bit as I sort of end, and we can talk about a number of things in passing, but there's a big question as to where this water comes from. And we know for a fact that as solar systems form, we form it as disks of dust and gas around young stars. All of the light material that's blown out by the young star, and this is actually not a theory, this is something you can observe. This is ALMA, the Atacama Large Millimeter Array Telescope, at 17,000 feet near San Pedro de Atacama, Chile. It's one of my favorite places in the world. I do okay at 17,000 feet. I get a little punchy, so you'll see me kind of running around being very, very happy. But I'm actually going to be going back here in 2019. I was here last year. I just loved it. At the base of this mountain, by the way, is one of the most incredible things. I'm not a very good photographer, but I took this picture. ALMA is in the valley to the right-hand side of that volcano, sort of up through that pass that you can just barely see. And the Atacama Desert is the driest place in the world. It basically never rains in the Atacama, very, very rarely. But you get snow melt coming off the high volcanoes. And it forms these wonderful salt plains at the basin that are full of life, including flamingos in the middle of the Atacama Desert. So there's a total eclipse of the sun coming through this area in 2019. And for those of you that are eclipse chasers, please consider going to the Atacama Desert. It's far more beautiful than you might think. It's gorgeous. Okay, well, the ALMA array has extremely high resolution. It can take incredibly small pixels on the sky. And it's one of the only instruments in the world that can actually look at detail in disks around forming stars and planets. And this is an ALMA image, and the image perhaps doesn't look all that exciting, but in the middle you have a young star with a swirling disk of gas around it. And you can actually see areas where the chemistry is very dry, where pretty much all of what we call volatiles, things like oxygen and carbon dioxide and water vapor, have been blown out. And then as you get farther away from the star, these things can condense. And then this was always our explanation as to why our solar system is the way it is, that you have rocky, solid planets near the star, and then farther out, you have bigger gaseous, maybe a liquid, all kinds of wonderful things farther out. And we can talk a bit about how this pattern holds up and doesn't hold up when you look at other stars. But the question then remains is, how did the water come back here? The Earth doesn't have a lot of liquid water, but it obviously has some. I'm drinking my iced tea right now. And you know, a lot of you probably have heard this, and this is kind of mind-blowing, that you know, we now believe that pretty much all the terrestrial water came from the outer solar system back to the Earth. How did it get here from the outer solar system is in bodies like this. Comets and asteroids. This is the comet 67GP. I'm not going to try to pronounce the name. But this is about an 8-kilometer-across mountain of rock and ice. And last year, the Europeans flew the Rosetta orbiter and the Philae lander out to it. And NASA is actually thinking about returning to this comet. This is a comet that comes back fairly close to the Earth and Sun every few years. But these pictures blew me away. Because when you talk about there being real pictures, I mean, that's really what a comet looks like. A mountain of ice and rock going through space. The Europeans brought along a small lander, and they wanted to sample the water on this comet to see if it matched isotopically, chemically, the water on Earth. And they selected a couple of really good landing sites. And the idea was to land the small lander, and it had pitons that were supposed to fire and stick it into the ice. And unfortunately, the pitons didn't fire, or they didn't fire correctly. This is a real picture. And what you're seeing is a time lapse of this little lander going down and then bouncing along the surface, because it never managed to stick itself into the ice. So you start over here on this side, and that little triangle is actually the lander. The cameras from the orbiter are taking this. And you can see it go bounce, 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 until unfortunately it bounces up against the side of a cliff on the comet. And that's okay. That was fine. You were able to sample the water. The problem was that the probe charged itself with solar panels, and so it wasn't able to charge up the batteries because it didn't have a good angle on the sun. So we only were able to operate it for about 3 days. But we were able to sample the ice of the comet in those 3 days. And this is a picture from the lander up against the wall of that comet. It's like, that doesn't this up. We have a lander on a comet. And you know, another thing that doesn't suck is you can actually still see it on the orbiter. So there's a picture of the head of that comet. There's a little red square at the very top right-hand corner. And then that red square is basically, you know, this area here. Then they can actually see the lander against the wall. This thing is amazing. So we sampled the comet water. It's similar to the water on Earth, but it's actually not an exact match. We found other places in the solar system that are a better match for the water in our bodies than the oceans. And here's an example of one. Anybody know what body this is? Ceres, yes, this is the largest asteroid. We actually have a lot of samples of the asteroid belt because they arrive here as meteorites. And there are often inclusions of water, liquid water, in meteorites. Goddard has an entire laboratory that studies this. And in fact, the isotopic ratio of water from meteorites and asteroids is much more of a match for us. So we think that, you know, over the billion-year history of the Earth, the meteorites that actually hit us brought water little by little, comets. You know, go out and look at the ocean and think about how many impacts that must have been, which is just crazy. And then Ceres is particularly interesting because we think Ceres might have a good amount of liquid water today. And as you notice, as we were approaching Ceres, we were beginning to map the surface. Oh, look at it, look at it. So that's called the oculus structure, which because it looked like two eyes looking at us, and we were not expecting it. So the really embarrassing thing was that as we brought the, this is from the Dawn spacecraft, as we brought it up to Ceres, and Ceres is about 600-700 miles across, about that. It's a big thing. You know, we were not expecting anything shiny on Ceres at all. And we sort of had to run and say, what the hell was that? And we weren't at a very good angle to take a picture of it for a while. But eventually we actually got to that crater. The crater's about 60 miles across. And what those bright spots were actually salts and deposits that we think are from recently wet minerals. And in fact, if you go right into the very heart of that crater, into the very middle of the crater, and we think it's probably not a coincidence. You know, something hit this asteroid. The crust is a little bit thinner there. And so you actually have stuff leaching through. It almost looks as if there's an ice dome structure, as if something is pushing up pressure-wise from the inside of that crater. And we now wonder if Ceres might not have a reservoir of liquid water underneath the surface. So when you think of asteroids, you think of these kind of dry, dead rocks. But especially some of the larger ones may actually have a good deal of water. And in fact, Ceres has so much water on it, we think, that we wonder if it actually belongs to the asteroid belt at all. It's in the asteroid belt now. It's the largest of the asteroids. But we're beginning to wonder if things move around in solar systems more than we thought they did. We're actually going out to sample an asteroid later this year. We arrive in June. This is the OSIRIS-REx spacecraft. And it is going out to retrieve a pristine sample of the asteroid Bennu. Bennu is about half a kilometer across, and it's one of the asteroids that crosses the path of the Earth's orbit. And so this is actually going to start scanning the asteroid this June. It's going to send a robotic arm down, scoop some asteroid material up, put it in a canister, and fly back to us. So soon we'll have a wonderful sample of the asteroid belt. I just want to show you, I mentioned there's a lot of things changing in how we understand the solar system. And a lot of that had to do with our understanding of other solar systems. Because now we no longer have just one example of the solar system. I screen grabbed this today from the website exoplanets.nasa.gov, which is a site that's run by the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. And this is the current count of the number of planets around other stars that we know of for sure. So 3,605 confirmed planets. We're following up on another 4,500 candidates, practically. And the reason they're candidates is that most of these were found by what they call the transit method, where you actually see the little planet cross above the star. And you need to have the same thing come back several times in order to confirm that it was a planet. Stars have sunspots, you know, the way the sun does. So if you just see something go across the surface of the star, and we do this just by measuring the light from the star, you can't say that was a planet. It needs to come back again and again. So, you know, right now we're following up on something on the order of, you know, 8,000 planets around other stars. And we can begin to look at some of the larger scale patterns. So, you know, this is the Kepler spacecraft. And Kepler is now ending its mission. We're almost out of fuel. We're launching a new exoplanet mission called TESS later this summer. So we're at the very, very end of this particular lifetime. I mean, Kepler was amazing. and it really changed the statistics. So on this graph, you actually see proportionally, after Kepler discovering all these thousands of planets, what proportion of stars in the sky have planets of what size? And it's pretty amazing to think that about, you know, between 15 and 20% of the stars that you see in the sky have an Earth-sized planet. The most common type of planet is one we don't have in our solar system. It's called a super-Earth, something about 3 to 5 times the mass of the Earth. And we don't know whether these things are more similar to a rocky planet like Earth, or are they a small gaseous planet. You know, we're actually sort of studying that right now. But you know, a full 20% or more of the stars in the sky have a super-Earth around them. And then a little bit about as common, so as I mentioned, there's sort of these super-Earth mini-Neptunes. So that the most common planets are ones that are sort of between the size of the Earth and the size of the gas size planets, the gas giants. As you can see here, not many stars yet have confirmed large planets. But that shouldn't surprise you, because there's a selection effect here. Kepler's only been working for, I think, about 7 years. The orbit of Jupiter itself is 12 years, right? So, I mean, any sort of large planet, you may not have even seen come around once, let alone twice. So for the very larger gas planets, we haven't confirmed them yet. There's some out there, but those are going to take a little more time. Red dwarf stars are particularly good to find exoplanets, because in the case of red dwarf stars, the red dwarfs are not very massive. So as the planets go around, you can actually watch the star wobble as it goes around. And then red dwarfs are wonderful for that. So in fact, we actually find lots and lots of planets around red dwarfs. I might have time to tell you a little about one system. Have you heard about the TRAPPIST system? That's an amazing one, right? So that's a red dwarf system. And that one has 7 confirmed planets that are the size of the Earth. And in fact, there was a press release that came out just a couple days ago that we now have been probing some of the chemistry of them using the Hubble Space Telescope. And we're not sure yet, but some of them may have huge amounts of water. We don't know whether it's ice or liquid water yet. But if you actually look at the density of these planets, they're not as dense as they should be, so they may be largely water. So we've seen enough exoplanets now that we actually, one of the things I love at JPL is they make travel posters for them. So a super Earth would actually have a higher surface gravity than the Earth does. So skydiving would be intense, right? That would be really accelerated as well. We found planets around binary stars, 2 stars orbiting each other. So you'd have 2 shadows where your shadows are. We've actually found planets that have apparently been kicked out of their solar systems. We call them rogue planets. So, I mean, it sounds a little sad. If you don't have any sunlight, that means that the nightlife never ends. So, J3.8.5-22, where the nightlife never ends. So, seriously, these are available from the JPL website, and they're really a lot of fun. And then I mentioned this TRAPPIST system. So TRAPPIST is a red dwarf system where we have 7 confirmed planets. This is an artist's conception of what those planets might look like. We don't know this to be true. We don't know what the surface of these would be like. The reason they've drawn some of them with liquid water on them is that they should be about the right temperature, the right distance away from their star, to have a temperature that could sustain liquid water. And they appear to have densities that say that there's a lot of water there. The amazing thing about these worlds is how small this solar system is. You can see the entire TRAPPIST system would fit well within the orbit of Mercury. And in fact, it's only a couple times larger than Jupiter and its largest moons. So this is a tiny little system. And there are 7 Earth-sized planets packed into that area. What that means is that if you were actually on the surface of one of these planets, you would see the worlds as surfaces in the sky. They wouldn't just be points of light. You would actually see the surfaces of the other planets. I mean, this is a real solar system, where you could stand on an Earth-like planet, possibly with liquid water, look into the sky and see other planets up there. Just amazing. This is something that I really encourage you to do more research on. I have a podcast called Orbital Path, and I've talked to a number of people on there about this idea that I'm going to talk about called the Grand Tack Hypothesis. So as I mentioned, our solar system has this wonderfully clear, logical way of having the rocky planets inside and the gaseous larger planets towards the outside, where there was more stuff that could condense and cool down and you can form planets out. The very first exoplanets we ever found back in the 90s completely threw this out. So if you remember back to the mid-1990s, this is a little diagram. And it shows you the very first solar systems we found. There's our solar system as a diagram at the top. there were planets many times the mass of Jupiter, or similar to the mass of Jupiter, well within the orbit of Mercury. So the idea that the giant gassy planets formed farther out didn't hold up for the very first solar systems we found outside our own. And in fact, some of these giant Jupiter planets appear to be at orbits that were very unstable, almost comet-like. They were coming in and might even collide with the star. And we began to wonder how solar systems really are formed, and we realized we'd forgotten something. That I showed you that picture of that ALMA disk of gas around the star. When planets form, they're forming inside a thick disk of gas, and it drags on the orbits. And they call this the grand tack hypothesis, and it's a sailing term. When you tack against the wind, you can actually move sort of in the opposite direction that you should. And then we began to do computer models about what would happen in the inner solar system, in the outer solar system, billions of years ago, when there was still lots of dust and gas in the disk. And what happens is that planets begin to move in and out and change places and interact with each other. And we think we have a lot of evidence of this now when we look at other solar systems. Jupiter's actually moving in. They formed farther out, but now they tack in towards their sun. And the model suggested that something like this happened, that the red ball that you see as the very first large thing, sort of the proto-Jupiter, we think actually formed somewhere around, a little bit outside the orbit of Mars, and then moved in, and then eventually moved back out again as the other outer planets began to form, began to nudge it back out with their gravity. And the same thing, the yellow ball is a proto-Saturn. So we think that these worlds may actually have moved around in the history of the solar system billions of years ago. There's a lot of things that people are putting into this pattern. Like we talked about Ceres, the largest asteroid. Ceres has so much water on it, we wondered if it formed in the outer solar system and came in with the giant planets. The giant planets' gravity basically brought it in. And then another thing that people are considering, and this will be what I end on, is where is our super Earth? The most common type of planet is a planet that we don't have. And there's a scientist at Caltech named Mike Brown, and he was the person that is famous for having killed Pluto. Pluto is still fine, it's still a fascinating place. But he was the person that found the other objects in basically Pluto's orbit, including Eris, which is more massive than Pluto. So it was a question of, do we start adding all these other planets, or do we call Pluto one of a family? And you may have heard that Mike Brown has suggested that if you look at the orbits of the bodies in our outer solar system, we may have missed a planet. And I'm not talking a little planet. They're estimating something 3 to 5 times the mass of the Earth. He's looked at the orbits. The orbits on the left-hand side of the page are known Kuiper Belt objects, objects out around the orbit of Mercury. And their perihelion, where they come in closest to the sun, they're all strangely lined up. All of these objects come in and pass the sun at almost the same point. And there's no reason that should happen unless there's a large gravitational body out there kind of herding them into these orbits. And that's where he got the estimate that this would be somewhere around 3 to 5 times the mass of the Earth. So if Jupiter and the large planets moved around in the past, they may have kicked planets all over the place. So there may have been planets that got thrown into the sun. There may have been planets that got thrown out entirely. And it may be that there's another massive planet out there that got thrown into an outer orbit that we weren't even aware of, possibly by the motion of Jupiter. So the hunt is on right now. And all of the best telescopes in the world are scanning the sky to see if we confirm that there's another big planet out there. So it's very possible that in the next few years, we're going to come back with an entirely different view of our solar system. A different planet farther out than we ever thought was there, and maybe a missing super Earth. So there's a lot to come. Okay, I'll end there. Thank you very much.